the Nigerian Economic Summit Group in its role as connector, dialogue partner, watchdog, and intervener.
When you first start business, your target is to make your first million.
Seeks to change the narrative and trajectory of the Nigerian economy. Together with our partners, we're not just solving problems, but preventing them, because when advocacy succeeds, the nation transforms for the better. But advocacy is for the strong. It takes fact-based inputs, resilience, partnerships, courage, and a lot of heroes. So be our hero. Subscribe to our channel, listen to our messages, and engage with us. Together, we can transform Nigerian lives, communities, and businesses. Welcome to the NESG Radio. Hello there. Welcome to NESG Radio. I'm your host, Yinka Inyolakom. The 26th Nigerian Economic Summit was a suitable platform to deliberate on the emerging pathways to the future for the country's economy. The theme of the summit, Building Partnerships for Resilience, was considered to be appropriate in shaping the big conversations for action. Participants also agreed that the summit pillars, which were collaboration, execution, and impact, were central to the successful implementation of the NEST 26 recommendations. The discussions were structured around five sub-themes. They were mapping the future, new trends, new opportunities, new horizons, embracing technology and innovation, building resilience, and finally, charting the path to recovery. So take a listen to the chairman NESG, Mr. Aswe Ighodalo, and the federal minister for finance, budget, and national planning, Dr. Zainab Ahmed, talk about the 26th Nigerian Economic Summit report. Take a listen.
I am really pleased to be presenting a summary of the recommendations of the 26th Nigerian Economic Summit, formally to the Honorable Minister, for adoption and onward transmission to Mr. President and to FEC, and hopefully implementation of salient aspects of this recommendation that Mr. President and the Honorable Minister in their wisdom believe will help leapfrog and move the economy of our great country even faster and much more, I'm using the word brisk. I think, as you all are aware, we're in difficult times, but difficult times enable tough people to do necessary things. And I think that's the focus of the government and the focus of the economic aspect or the economic team of government, ably led by the Honorable Minister. So, Madam Minister, thank you, and I'd like to thank you before I go to the recommendations in full for your strong support for the 26th summit and all other summits we've held since you came into office. You insisted last year that we hold the summit because at the time the summit was first scheduled, we had NSARS and then there was the wave of the pandemic. But the Honorable Minister insisted that it was important we held the summit. So we all convened here, and others joined us virtually on the 23rd and 24th of November. The theme of our 26th summit was Building Partnership for Resilience. And like I had said before, the turmoil unleashed by COVID-19, as well as the NSARS protests, was paramount in the minds of all Nigerians at the time we convened for the 26th summit. We had over 6,400 national and global policymakers, business leaders, NGOs, development partners, emir, scholars, youths, and citizens joining. 350 physically attended, and slightly over 6,000 joined us virtually. We had 8 plenary sessions, 16 high-level panels, 5 design workshops, 4 CEO roundtables, and we had previously, before the summit, had 14 pre-summit events. There was a strong and optimistic anticipation that NEST26 would be a suitable platform to deliberate on the emerging pathways for the future of our economy. And so we settled on that theme, building partnership for resilience. And this theme was considered to be appropriate in the circumstances of our country at the time. Discussions at the summit were dimensioned around 5 sub-themes. The first one was mapping the future. And the second was new trends, new opportunities, new horizons. The third was embracing technology and innovation. The fourth was building resilience, and the fifth was charting a path to recovery. Recovery from the vicissitudes of the pandemic and some of our underlying or comorbidities. After 2 days of extensive and robust deliberations with full participation, the participants came to many far-reaching recommendations across 5 thematic outcomes, and I'll enumerate the thematic outcomes. The first was that we needed to ensure a resilient economic recovery, particularly from where we were coming at the end of the third quarter. We'd seen we had 2 bad quarters because of the pandemic and its outcomes, dropping oil prices, low demand, and it was fundamental that we needed to ensure that we emerged solidly from all of this. We also all agreed at the summit that we needed to strengthen partnerships. Thirdly, we agreed that we needed to unlock subnational competitiveness. Our states needed to become more competitive. Our states needed to be more focused on their development, enhance their IGR, make themselves credible investment destinations, and our states are really the first or the connecting rod to the majority of the people. So it was important that we focused on the competitiveness of our states. And then meeting our sustainable development goals by 2030, there are 17 of these goals, and it was important for us to reemphasize the fact that we needed to make haste in meeting these goals so as to ensure the sustainability and massive, quick development of our economy. And our fifth was empowering the Nigerian youth, and that had become fundamental, again, on the back of the NSAS protests and the realization that we're having challenges with education. We are having massive employment challenges. A lot of our youths that came out of their school, out of universities, vocational schools, and polytechnics, were finding it very difficult to find employment. Statistics suggest that maybe 1 in 6 actually do find gainful employment, and the majority of them were underemployed. So, which in itself is a major problem and can be a time bomb if not addressed effectively and very quickly. As regards our outcomes, I'll very quickly run through the recommendations for each outcome. As regards ensuring a resilient economic recovery, summit attendees agreed that we needed to achieve and maintain macroeconomic stability to ensure economic growth that would outpace our population growth, create jobs, stabilize inflation, and we see that inflation numbers keep going up, reduce poverty, and expand external balance of payments. It was also proposed that we needed to really deal with the issue of multiple exchange rates, and we needed to unify exchange rates into a single and market-driven window. attendees suggested and recommended that we need to improve coordination of fiscal, monetary, and structural policies so that they work in tandem in a synergized manner. It was also important that we aggressively attract foreign direct investment, not just foreign direct investment, even domestic investment. We needed to attract domestic investment and foreign direct investment so that it will dovetail into our job creation proposals. We also needed to deregulate the oil sector by the passage of the PIB. One important point that was made at the summit, which we all agreed to, was that a prompt passage of the PIB would signal to the international community and foreign investors that we truly were focused on attracting investment and were focused on doing business. And so it was going to be two-pronged. It would create policy for the oil and gas sector that were certain, which investors like the certainty of policies. And importantly, it will also signal to international and domestic investors that truly we were ready, willing, and accommodating of investments. For a while, there had been this feel, particularly internationally, that we were becoming more difficult as an investment destination. So we thought the passage of the PIB would help signal differently. It was also proposed that we needed to tighten fiscal coordination and intensify investments in social sectors and encourage more private participation in the economy, which I spoke about, and private participation in social sectors of the economy. Particularly in infrastructure, we needed to create an environment where private capital flowed into infrastructure. Government cannot by itself cope with the infrastructure requirements of this country. And so it was fundamental that we created an environment where funds flow towards infrastructure. There's about 17 trillion of capital that earns zero income. Some of that capital, if we made ourselves attractive enough, should flow towards our country and towards infrastructure in our country. The second outcome was a determination that we needed to truly strengthen partnerships. We're working with the Governors Forum, and tomorrow we will inaugurate a technical roundtable where the NESG and the Governors Forum would start the process or continue the process of working substantially together to help subnationals look at their competitive environment and help improve their competitive environment and their attractiveness for investments, help with how they can improve on their IGRs. So that would be 2 p.m. tomorrow. We were also proposing that the private sector needed to assist in the management of vocational and other training institutions so as to be able to identify industry standards and inculcate those standards into the curriculum of those institutions so that those who graduate from those institutions are fit for purpose. So the private sector would work with the Ministry of Education and with government to manage these institutions and inculcate fit-for-purpose curriculum into those institutions. The private sector was also required and enjoined to focus extensively on digital transformation. This is an economic growth, this would substantially transform the economic growth of the country, particularly in this digital age. We came to the decision also that the primary healthcare, particularly coming out of the experiences of the pandemic, needed substantial reform through public-private sector partnerships. And we saw some of these partnerships during the height of the pandemic. And we said a lot more of this needed to be done. Also, collaboration in creating the appropriate business environment. And earlier on today at another event, it was emphasized that business needed to work more with government to suggest policies for creating an attractive environment. Government and businesses were also enjoined to create a task force on the future of work to ensure Nigeria is keeping up with cutting-edge developments as they are all over the world, particularly in emerging economies. We also thought it would be a proper thing to do to engage Nigerians in the diaspora and leverage on their expertise for development of key sectors of our economy, particularly in the health sector, in the education sector, and request of them to bring in capital for investment in the country. They know the country better than other foreign investors, and it will be a relatively low-hanging fruit to persuade them to invest in the economy. The third outcome, the third heading, is unlocking subnational competitiveness. And I've already talked about the roundtable that will be inaugurated tomorrow between the Nigerian Governors Forum and the Nigerian Economic Summit Group. There was also another issue that came up today, earlier on, and had to do with looking at our constitution to move certain things from the exclusive legislative list so as to ensure that the states can have statutory oversight over certain things that would help quickly develop the economies of the state. So we were proposing, through the National Assembly and the states and the private sector, constitutional reform so as to move these items to the concurrent list, and this will help the subnationals. And we listed some of those items to move into, particularly like policing, mining, minerals, and some other such items that would help drive the economies of the states. Subnationals need to develop their competitive advantages, and they needed to come up with industrial policies as a tool to identify and attract foreign direct investment into their states. They needed to also focus on job creation as a quick win, generating jobs, promoting exports, and enhancing their revenues by granting certain reliefs to attract investments, tax reliefs. Many of them are creating industrial parks, so they needed to provide infrastructure to these parks and ensure that these parks work well and these parks attract the level of industries that they require. Industries that give that they have comparative advantage in. It was also proposed that we create economic corridors around transport corridors. So where we have transport corridors, rail line, road, trunk roads, that we should create economic corridors around those areas. We propose that we decentralize infrastructure development and states should increase investments in infrastructure, especially rural roads, water, irrigation, and rural electrification. The Sustainable Development Goals, meeting them by 2030, was also a fundamental priority, and we propose and we're recommending to government that we should recognize stronger multi-stakeholder efforts to achieve meeting these Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. We propose that we establish a high-level forum of SDGs and ensure that the SDGs become the centerpiece of development planning. We're in the middle of certain development planning documentation, and it was proposed that this be the fulcrum of the SDGs be the fulcrum of these development plans. Subnationals are required to integrate the SDGs into their policies and plans, and we hope that the business community, companies, would adopt a business-driven approach to sustainable development as investments, which will be achieving sustainable revenues. We have recommended that SMEs be engaged in the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals because SMEs are the largest employers of labor and they're the biggest job creators. All the governments, national and subnational, should deploy policy incentives to encourage companies that are committed to the SDGs. So companies that are committed to SDGs should be giving certain consideration for certain waivers or exemption or support so as to continue encouraging those companies. The fifth and final major recommendation or recommendation heading is empowering our youth. We need to tackle youth unemployment head on. Unemployment, underemployment, and their employability. That has been fit for purpose. Children graduate from schools and they can't read. Children and students graduate from universities and they haven't learned very much. So they are not skilled to go into the job market, especially the job market as it's becoming more innovative, more IT-oriented, and more complicated. My time is up. Okay. But it's important that we look at education and we reskill and retool our youth so that they are fit for purpose. We're looking at scaling up formal apprenticeship programs, encourage informal apprenticeship schemes through accreditations and certifications, facilitate the development of critical industries to absorb more youths, and then get our youths engaged in policy and governance across governments. We need to encourage our youths, mentor them, and get a lot more of them involved in policy formation and in governance. The NESG, for instance, has the Bridge Fellowship Program, which can be replicated across subnationals and institutions. We've asked that we establish a platform, either in collaboration with the NESG, for Nigerian youth to collaborate and work with governments in preferring solutions to the challenges in the different sectors. At the end of the summit, we made a call to action, and we've asked specifically that because of the effect of the pandemic, we need to vigorously accelerate the need to retool our economic policy to capitalize on the opportunities that emerge in the changing dynamics of the local, regional, and global economic landscape, so that no Nigerian is left behind and that the world does not leave Nigeria behind. This requires bold structural reforms to create the necessary conditions for markets to function and a commitment to sustain them. All our governments must lead the way in proactively navigating the country towards recovery. Governments at all levels must unlock more private sector participation by removing sectoral rigidities. I said earlier at a function today that I think we're overregulated in this country, and we really need to look to it. We need to make the environment attractive and enabling. It's now. Madam Minister, we look forward to the adoption of the recommendations of the 26th Summit and the implementation of the key recommendations by the federal government and by state governments. We will also be engaging with state governments. I sincerely thank the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria on behalf of my board, President Muhammadu Buhari, GCFR, for his strong support of the summit process. I also thank our Vice President, Professor Shibaju. I especially thank our partners in the summit process, ably led by you, Madam Honorable Minister, and the Honorable Minister of State, Chief Clem Agba, and the permanent secretaries in your ministry. We're truly grateful because without your support and without the collaboration, we would not achieve all the things we achieve. God bless the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and thank you very much for listening. We thank you.
Thank you, sir. I have worked with Mr. Godale for years over this annual summit. He's one Nigerian that is so passionate about how to develop Nigeria economy. Soft-spoken, very, very frank. His recommendations are always to the point. So on this note, can you give him another round of applause? Let me, at this juncture, invite Her Excellency, Dr. Mrs. Zainab S. Ahmed, the Honorable Minister for Finance, Budget and National Planning. Can we rise to welcome her to the podium? Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone that is here today. Special greetings to the chairman of NESG, CEO of NESG, and the permanent secretary, Ministry of Budget and National Planning, Director, Macroeconomic Planning, distinguished guests that are here. But the special guests that we have today are our brothers and sisters on the press, gentlemen of the press, 2021, by Allah's grace. So the chairman and I are presenting what we call the Green Book to the public. This is the report of the 22nd Nigeria Economic Summit, which had the theme Building Partnerships and Resilience, for resilience.
Thank you for listening. You can download the full reports on www.nesgroup.org/26. Thank you for listening to our content today. Remember to subscribe to the NESG Radio. Follow us across all social media channels and visit our website www.nesgroup.org/NESG Radio. NESG, in the national interest.